Everybody, and thank you for joining us here on King Jordan Radio for August 20th, 2013. As we get closer to Michael Jackson's birthday, ladies and gentlemen, let's bring back the man who successfully defended Michael Jackson in 2005, the one and only Tom Mesereau. Good evening, Tom. How are you?
Hi, Jordan. I'm doing well. Thank you for the kind introduction.
No problem. How was the summer?
Good. It's been a very busy summer for us. I've been moving from Los Angeles to Las Vegas to San Francisco, various matters I'm involved in, and everything's doing fine. Can't complain.
Right. That's great to hear. Today on the show, I wanted to start with the 2005 trial. Now, having an interview with Tom Sneddon. Now, this sounds like a very angry prosecutor, and I want to give the credit to Luna Joe for providing me for this video information. So let's take a listen. This is after the feat, the day after Tom Sneddon is interviewed. I don't know if you heard it. Let's play it, and we'll take a list. We'll talk about it on the other side.
Prosecutor Tom Sneddon, yesterday, a day his office suffered a crushing defeat at the hands of Michael Jackson's jury. Well, tonight, he's talking about what happened. MSNBC's own Rita Cosby. Rita joins us now in Scarborough Country. Rita.
Joe, Tom Sneddon was quite fiery during this interview, and for the first time we hear how the boy who accused Michael Jackson of molestation reacted to the verdict. We at MSNBC, in order to protect the boy's privacy, have chosen to remove his name, so you may at times not hear the audio for a brief second during the interview. But what you will hear is a boisterous prosecutor who defends his case through and through. First, I asked the district attorney if he was personally devastated by the jury's decision.
We felt that we did the best job that we could, and that's it. I mean, that's our philosophy, you know. You do the best you can, and we're not the judge and we're not the jury. We're the people who put on the case, and we feel that we did a very good job.
Well,
an excellent job.
Did you talk to the boy? What was his reaction?
He was very discouraged. He was, as you would expect, a young 15-year-old boy who everybody in the world now knows the jury didn't believe what he said, was very discouraged. He couldn't understand it and was down, and I talked to him at length and told him to get his chin up, that he was a very courageous young man and that he had done the right thing. And, you know, that's the whole thing about this, is, we did the right thing for the right reason. He did, too, and it didn't go our way, but, you know, life goes on, and his life will go on, and it will be a very good life. He's a very courageous young man.
What did he say to you specifically?
He asked me a couple of times, what happened? Why didn't they believe me? I tried to explain to him that I couldn't tell him that in our opinion, we believed in him and continue to believe in him, and that I told him that basically this is a chapter of your life that's closed. Close it up and get on with your life. Go back to school, play your sports, and be a good person, be somebody, and he will, because he's that kind of person.
Is there any doubt in your mind after talking to this boy that Michael Jackson did not molest him?
There never has been from the very first time I met him.
So you believe that Michael Jackson molested this boy, even to this day?
We Look, Rita, it's this simple. Not only do I believe that, but all the people associated with this case who's had an opportunity to be with, to hear, to interact with, this is not Tom Snedden. This decision to go forward with this case was a decision that was made by a team of people, a number of lawyers beyond myself, and there isn't a person involved in that decision that in any way, shape, or form has ever wavered in their belief that was telling the truth.
And you believe that to this day?
Of course.
The jury, though, another team, you know, 8 women, 4 men, said no way. They said the evidence wasn't there.
That's what they said, and I don't quarrel with juries. But you're asking me what my belief is, and my belief is has not wavered, and it will not waver ever in that regard. And that's why we have juries, instead of having prosecutors make those decisions.
Is it possible, though, sir, that this boy and this mother, who have lied before in other cases like the JCPenney case, totally fooled you guys, and they were lying again?
No, and then that's a misrepresentation of what happened in JCPenney's.
How so? Because even it sounds like she had exaggerated some things before.
Well, all right. Exaggerating is not the same thing as being a liar. And what a mother does and says is different from what a child says or does. And you were asking me specifically about, and I don't think that if the mother had even done something wrong, that you visit the sins of the mother on the son. If you have real belief in the integrity of what the young child was telling you. So I think that, you know, this tendency to kind of mesh these things together as if one's dependent on the other, I think is probably a fallacy which a lot of people have bought into, perhaps even the jury. But like I said, I'm not quibbling with the jury's verdict. I'm just, you're asking me my personal opinion, and I'm telling you that there isn't a person associated with the prosecution of this case that has ever wavered in their belief in.
What do you say to people who say that you personally had a personal vendetta against Michael Jackson, that you were driven by it, that you spent all this taxpayer money, hundreds, you know, of search warrants, tons of time, and it was a waste of taxpayers' money because the jury sort of laughed it off?
Rita, first of all, there weren't 100 search warrants in this case. Second of all, we didn't spend a ton of money. And third of all, that whole idea of a revenge is such nonsense. I say that you folks in the media that really believe that garbage, come down here and check my life. See what I've been doing the last 10 years. You know, I have a family. I have a large family. I have grandkids. I play sports. I work in the community. I volunteer my time. If you think I have given this one passing thought once that case ended in 1993 and 94, You're not in touch with reality. I mean, I had a chance to make cost probably $1 million writing a book on that case and turned it down.
Will you ever write a book?
To go on,
will you ever write a book on this?
I had chances. Probably not. I don't. But I mean, I had a chance back then to do that. I had a chance to go on TV. I had a chance to be interviewed. I never said one word after that press conference, ever in 10 years.
Now,
so I mean,
go ahead.
It's the truth. I mean, just look at it. It's the truth. I never, people would, every time he would do something, they would call me from a comment everywhere, Japan, France, England, New York, everywhere. The media would go crazy, and I didn't take any of those calls. I never made a comment about anything. I really, really, really was not involved in following Michael Jackson's life when said he was not going to cooperate with our investigation. That was over with, and I moved on. And that's the truth. I know that doesn't make it nice for you folks because it doesn't sell, but that's the truth.
There is word tonight that Jackson and his team, I guess, have indicated that they want you to immediately surrender these photos that were taken, that you have access to, of Michael Jackson's private parts, that they are fearful that they're going to be leaked out in the press somehow. Will you surrender those photos?
Rita, that's just another instance where the defense team doesn't know what they're talking about. I don't have those photos. The sheriff's department doesn't have those photos. Nobody can get those photos without a court order. There are only 3 names on the signature to get in there, and you need signatures from 2 of them and a judge's approval. So this is just typical of what's been going on in this case ever since it's happened. The people don't know what they're talking about, and it's not true.
So what do you say to Michael Jackson's team who are saying, we're worried that Tom Snedden's going to leak this out?
It's the same old nonsense. I can't leak out what I can't get to, can I?
So you can guarantee that they won't
be leaked out? I don't
have
the negatives. What did I just tell you? Nobody can get access to them without a judge's approval.
So they're not going anywhere, is what you're saying?
That's what I said, and that's what I've been saying, and that's the truth.
Now, if you saw Michael Jackson,
of these things where,
if you saw Michael Jackson on the street, you ran into him, or run into him again, what would you say to him?
That's a highly unlikely scenario.
But if it were to happen,
I'm going to run into each.
What would you say to him if you could see him? If you happen to run into him,
I wouldn't say anything. I'd probably nod and keep walking.
Would you walk away?
I said I'd probably nod and keep walking. I wouldn't go out of my way to avoid him. I don't feel any vindictiveness towards this man. In a lot of respects, he's a fairly pathetic person in the sense of what he's gone through. And I don't have any vendetta against him. It's just that simple.
Are you sad, sir, as your term is ending? That this is this may be the last, huge case. You're certainly never going to have a case like this with a year and a half left in your term. You sad this is the way you're going out?
No, I just don't think you people understand who I am. And who I am is that I tell the kids that I've coached and I tell my kids that I've raised that if you do the best job that you can possibly do and you do it for the right reasons, whether you win or whether you lose is unimportant. The question is, can you walk off the field at the end of the game with your chin up and say, I gave it my all, and I played fair and square, and I did the right thing? If you've done that, you've got nothing to apologize for, nothing to put your head down about, and I'm proud of my office, I'm proud of the people who participated, I'm proud of the Sheriff's Department, and if anybody thinks that because we lost this case that I'm going to walk around in a sackcloth with my chin down around my knees, it's crazy, because I'm not.
Our thanks to the District Attorney.
Tom Mesereau, I want to get your response to some of the interesting and quite aggressive comments from former District Attorney Tom Snedden.
Well, first of all, I never heard that interview before. I gather
really?
It took place the day after the acquittals. Is that correct?
That is correct.
Yeah, I do remember his making some comments on the day of the acquittals. He gave a press conference, which I chose not to do. My law firm partner and co-counsel, Susan, you and I decided not to give a press conference, which could have given us tremendous publicity all over the world. We felt it was more important that we be with Michael at Neverland. And we, instead of doing the press conference, we drove to Neverland and spent time with Michael and his children and his family. But I had not heard this interview that was given the next day. Tom Snedden sounds like he really believes what he's saying. And I'm not going to say he's lying. I'm going to say that he's probably delusional because I believe he had a vendetta to get Michael. The information given to me was that after the settlement in 1993, that he personally traveled to Australia and Canada looking for witnesses against Michael Jackson. That was the information I was given. I was also given information that he contacted, or people on his behalf contacted, other young men around the world trying to find alleged victims of Michael Jackson. And the Sheriff's Department in Santa Barbara County had a website where they were looking for witnesses against Michael Jackson. So when I put all that together, as well as the fact that in 1993, he not only convened a grand jury in Santa Barbara County, he also had a lot to do with Los Angeles County convening a grand jury to investigate Michael Jackson. So I believe he and the people around him were obsessed with taking down Michael Jackson. And I believe they threw unlimited resources. I mean, the search of Neverland in November of 2003 had over 70 police officers.
It wasn't a lot of money. You heard him.
Well, that's ridiculous. I mean, I've never seen over 70 sheriffs conduct a search of a home in any other case. I mean, in cases of serial killers, you don't have 70 sheriffs conduct a search of a home. And if you look at those FBI reports that were released after Michael Jackson was acquitted, you'll see that Santa Barbara prosecutors, Ron Zonin and Gordon Auchincloss, are flying back and forth to Quantico, Virginia, meeting with FBI agents and experts They're going back and forth trying to get FBI involvement in the case. It appears they were trying to encourage the FBI to get federal prosecutors to bring a federal case against Michael Jackson. If you look at the discovery, they were consulting with Interpol, which is the International Police Force, to get their involvement and their ideas in how to convict Michael Jackson. The number of DAs involved was enormous in that investigation and trial. They seemed to have every conceivable expert on the planet. I remember when Randy Jackson called me one day in Los Angeles saying I had to jump in a helicopter to get to Neverland. It was a surprise raid. It was a raid after the raid in November of 2003. And it was a surprise raid. They wanted Michael Jackson's DNA. I jumped in a little helicopter in Los Angeles and flew right to Santa Barbara, landed on the Neverland Ranch. And when I got there, you had sheriffs everywhere. You had an accident reconstruction expert that was up in Michael Jackson's bedroom taking all kinds of measurements for hours. You had a computer graphics expert downstairs that I was talking to who was doing his investigation. I mean, they had, you know, they checked DNA. They checked every kind of trace evidence imaginable. They went through all of the computers. I mean, they had
everything.
Pardon me?
They were trying to look for kiddie porn, right?
Yes. They seized all of his computers. They had computer experts holding onto those computers for a long period of time, trying to find kiddie porn on the computers. They consulted every agency imaginable. They had their own jury consultant in the courtroom when they were picking a jury. I mean, I don't know what experts were left to consult. And the amount of time and resources and people that they spent, I think we'll never know the truth of that. I don't think it'll ever be revealed. But, you know, to say that he had no real agenda against Michael Jackson is ridiculous.
That's ludicrous. Yeah, and if you really listen to him, he sounds like he's like, you know, a baby that lost a game. He really sounds like he's trying to hold in what he really feels. Because every now and then he'll give the reporter a little bit, and you know he wants to say more, but he doesn't go because he knows he's on television or whatever the case is. But if you could actually see it visually, he's red while he's talking. As the journalist starts to, you know, as you heard, you know, her question if he still believed in Gavin Arvizio telling the truth, he started to turn red, courtesy of MSNBC. That was a very interesting clip that I really wanted you to hear if you didn't hear it.
No, I haven't. What happened was, as I said before, it was a day that I'll never forget. You know, Michael was acquitted on all 14 charges, 10 felonies, 4 misdemeanors. We were ecstatic. I walked out of the courtroom and decided not to just promote ourselves with a press conference. And we went to see Judge Melville and his staff and thanked them for treating us professionally. And then Susan and I chose to go to Neverland. We felt that we should be with Michael and his family.
You said three words, right? You said justice was done. The man was never the man was always innocent. Something along those lines, right?
I believe the words were justice is done. The man's innocent. He always was.
I
believe those are the words you're referring to. But I got up at 2:30 in the morning to do interviews on the morning shows, you know, Good Morning America, The Today Show, and the CBS Early Morning Show. A lot of people probably assumed I was partying or something that night. I didn't do anything like that. I had a quiet dinner and went to bed and got up to do the interviews, which I felt were very important to get our point across that Michael was not a molester, was not a criminal, was not a pedophile. And in the mix of things, I never heard this interview before. As you can imagine, my life was very wild at that point because I had every media station from every country in the world was trying to reach me, to interview me about the case, and I could only, you know, go on a handful of them. And it was just a day I'll never forget, but I did not hear this interview with Tom Stedden before, so I thank you for letting me hear it. I've talked to someone who has had some access to him in recent years, and they tell me that he'll never get over this. They tell me that the person I talked to said, at best, there seems to be a profound sense of sadness about him over losing this case. That was the best.
Oh, really? He took it personally?
Yeah, I think so. I think it was a huge blow to him, and I really believe he was trying to get Michael for, you know, a good 12 years. After the verdicts, I was asked to speak to the Los Angeles Grand Jury Association, which is an association of former grand jurors. And a woman came up to me. She was a conservative Republican. She said, "Mr. Messer, I want you to know that I was on that grand jury in 1993 that investigated the Chandler matter, and I tend to be very pro-law enforcement. I'm a very conservative person. But I have to tell you, there was something wrong with these witnesses. Things didn't add up. And I was very suspicious of the kind of case they were trying to put on in that grand jury room." Now, that's the Los Angeles grand jury that investigated him and didn't indict him. There was also a Santa Barbara grand jury that investigated and didn't indict him. When I kept yelling that these two grand juries in 93 never charged him with anything, Mr. Snedden and his minions at the DA's office were responding by saying, "Oh, they were just investigating. They weren't there to charge anyone," which was pure nonsense. As you know, in 2005, after they initially filed a criminal complaint against Michael, they decided to go to a grand jury and had a grand jury indict him. Now, in a grand jury in America, there is no judge and there is no defense attorney. It's done in secret. The public is not allowed in that room. A judge is not allowed in that room to control the proceedings. And defense lawyers are allowed in the room. So prosecutors basically put on witnesses. They're not cross-examined. They're not tested to see if they're telling the truth. And that's the only evidence a grand jury hears. So they decided
to... And 9 out of 10 times, a grand jury will indict. Like they, the old-fashioned word is, a grand jury can indict a ham sandwich. Is that true?
Exactly. Oh, I would say it's more than 9 out of 10. I think the 99.9% of the time, they return, you know, an indictment. So that was the route they chose to go. But eventually, everything got exposed in the courtroom in a public proceeding. You had more accredited media cover that trial than any trial in American history. And Michael
more than O.J. certainly, right?
Well, you had more media covering it than O.J. and Scott Peterson combined from around the world, because Michael Jackson was the most popular person in the world, the best-known celebrity on the planet. And
now, when you say media coverage, do you mean like all the networks from all over the world? Or do you mean ratings, or do you mean a combination of all?
Well, I'm not an expert on the subject, but NBC reported that NBC was announcing that the jury had reached verdicts, Brian Williams on NBC, he said, "To let you know how big this case is, we have over 2,200 accredited media from around the world. That's more than O.J. Simpson and Scott Peterson combined."
And you couldn't even, the viewers couldn't see, like O.J., and I don't know about Scott, I didn't see that. Were they able to visualize that one? I know Garrigo
the O.J. attorney trial. I'm sorry, go ahead.
I was going to say, I know Garagos was counsel for Scott, so they must have had cameras.
Well, the O.J. Simpson trial was televised. You had cameras in the courtroom. The Scott Peterson trial was not televised, but yes, you did have a lot of media coverage, for sure. And yes, Mr. Garagos was his attorney, and he's sitting on death row in a case that I think he could have avoided the death penalty with competent counsel, in my opinion. Remember, in that Scott Peterson case, you couldn't prove the time of death, the cause of death, or even the place of death. And you had a very presentable defendant. But Garagos didn't show up for the verdict, number one. And number two...
He didn't show up for the verdict?
Didn't show up for the verdict when the jury found him guilty of capital murder. You then went into the penalty phase where the jury was going to decide whether to sentence him to life without parole or death. And Garagos got up and told the jury he was not properly prepared, and they came back and sent him to death row.
So wait, when you say he wasn't really at the verdict, he wasn't at, like, the verdict that you were at when Michael was acquitted? He wasn't at the regular verdict or sentencing?
The verdict on guilt, he did not show up for. His co-counsel,
just the regular verdict.
Yes, when they came back and found his client guilty of murder with special circumstances, Garagos was not there. They then
in other words, he could have been acquitted, and Garagos wouldn't have been there.
That's correct.
Holy, I never heard anything like that.
It was mind-boggling to us, we criminal defense lawyers. It was just mind-boggling because if your client is convicted in a death penalty case of murder with special circumstances, the jury is watching the reaction on the defense lawyer's face. Because if you're convicted of that, you then go into the penalty phase, which is a second trial, where basically each side presents witnesses and evidence to try, and the prosecutors are arguing for death, and the defense is saying he or she should not go to death row. And, you know, I don't think it's a very good idea when the jury comes in and convicts your client that you're not there. To me, that sends a message that you don't even place a high value on the client yourself. So people that I know were shocked that he didn't show up for the verdict on guilt.
And especially in such a high-profile case. I mean, in the lowest-profile case, I would think counsel would be there. For the lowest of the low, you know, with all due respect to anybody else.
No, I was saying
you had a lot of media there, and he wasn't there.
Not for the initial verdict, no. He was there later on when they came back and said pronounced death. But he was not there for the initial verdict. He claimed that he had another engagement in Los Angeles, as I recall.
Oh, wow. That's crazy. I never heard of something like that.
Well, check it out on the check that on the internet. But at any rate, you know, I'm just surprised Mr. Snedden made the remarks he did, because I really think he was driven to convict Michael. I really do.
Yeah, and this idea of a book deal and all kinds of crazy stuff. Okay, you mind if we go to the calls?
No, not at all.
Okay, let's start with Deborah is calling us. Hi, Deborah.
Hi, Illinois. Hi, Jordan. Hi, Tom. This is Debbie Kunish.
How you doing?
Good. How are you?
I'm doing fine. Thank you.
Good. I've been listening, and I hadn't actually heard that clip either of Sten's interview. And what's kind of interesting is I want to say maybe it was about 2 years ago, I had someone who contacted me who had worked for L.A. County, and they wanted to remain anonymous. But one of the things that they told me was that they had seen firsthand that, at least from what they had witnessed and what they were telling me, was that Snedden had actually he had been involved in a lot of other things that were basically racially motivated. It was this person's belief that was one of the reasons that he was going after Michael Jackson, was that there was a racially motivated factor in there, because he had also gone after other people of different descents, I think Mexican and Spanish people, African American people. And I had found some things on the internet as well that seemed to coincide with that. So I don't know what your take is on that, Tom, but that was something that, you know, was interesting to me that this person contacted me about.
Well, I don't think race was the primary motive. It could have been a secondary motive. Mm-hmm. I don't know Eden well enough. But I think the desire for fame and fortune was a much more powerful motive When I met these prosecutors after I got in the case, you know, they were like walking on air. They were just so, in my opinion and based on my observations, they were so excited to be in this, you know, world event. Mm-hmm. And I think the public part of it, the fame, the media coverage, the interest around the world, and the possibility of becoming stars after it and writing books and getting, you know, large amounts of money and that kind of thing, I suspect that was much more of a motivation than racial bias.
Okay.
Now, I don't know how many of our viewers followed the case closely and read the transcripts, but my last witness in our defense case was Chris Tucker, a fabulous, fabulous friend of Michael Jackson. I saw him recently, and we hugged each other, and I told him, I said, "You're one of the real stand-up guys who stood by Michael when times were tough." I said, "You and Macaulay Culkin, I'll never forget, because you were both young men, enormously successful, enormously popular, and you were being advised by people around you, you know, managers, agents, lawyers, to stay away from this case for fear it might hurt your career. And I know the two of you said to everyone, 'Michael's our friend, and we're coming in and telling the truth.' And you really stood up for a friend when the chips were very down." And but he was my last witness, and Mr. Sneddon cross-examined him. And I suggest that anyone with an interest in your question, Debbie, read that cross-examination by Sneddon. I won't say much more than that.
Okay.
And Debbie, you're working on a project. You really want, you wanted to mention it?
Yeah. And I've actually told Tom a little bit about this in the past. I've been working on this for about a month, and we, and you and I, Jordan, along with my creative partner, we did an interview this past week. But we're putting on a show called I'm Bad, which is sort of coinciding with the 25th anniversary of the Bad album, and it's to honor Michael. We have a lot of talent, you know, on the show. Tajay Sullivan, who's the show's Michael, Mick Thompson, who danced with Michael for 9 years. He's our choreographer. We have Jack Faea, who is our director, and he was he's worked with Siegfried and Roy and all kinds of celebrities. And we just brought in Jabril Mowry, who's from Motown the Musical. He's incredible. He's going to be our little Michael Jackson. And if you can go on YouTube and put him in, he sounds exactly like Michael during the Jackson 5 era. Just really talented young man. But anyone who wants information on that could go to imbadlive.com and, you know, kind of keep in touch with where our show's going.
Sounds good. Sounds good indeed. Thanks for the call, Deb.
Yeah. Okay, thank you. Thanks, Jordan, and thank you, Tom.
Okay, bye, Debbie. Thanks.
Bye-bye.
Okay, Tom, during the trial, Gary Coleman was following it. I want to play an excerpt for this, and then we'll talk about it. You'll let me know if you heard it.
Gary Coleman, he's the star of the 70s TV series Different Strokes. He also starred in a run for governor of California, and he's now covering the Michael Jackson trial for All Comedy Radio. Gary, I want to ask you about this concept of having a childhood stolen and how Macaulay Culkin and Michael Jackson share that. But first things first, let's talk about the news of the day. You were there. Talk about the atmosphere around the trial today as Macaulay Culkin went in to testify for his friend Michael Jackson.
And I can certainly tell you, based on last week and this week, it's definitely appearing to me that this is a show trial. It's a revenge trial. Tom Sneddon always said he was going to try and get Michael Jackson one way or another. And it was really proven to me when he didn't redepose his witnesses on the stand when they didn't say what he wanted them to say to get Michael Jackson convicted. That really proved it to me.
Talk about Macaulay Culkin having a special bond with Michael Jackson, because they were, like you, they were both child stars. They both talked about having their childhood stolen. Do you think that Macaulay Culkin would be more likely to stick together with Michael Jackson or you, others like you, because you all have shared that same experience?
Oh, well, you know, in Hollywood, there's a group of people who actually do participate in that kind of hand-holding kind of atmosphere, a self-help, if you will. It's called a minor consideration. I don't know if Michael Jackson is into that kind of thing, but I certainly understand the kindred spirit aspect of it, except that's not something that I've ever experienced personally myself.
From what we understand, you're out there reporting for All Comedy Radio, is that correct?
I try to poke fun at the fact that Michael Jackson is in court for something that now, obviously, he didn't do. So I try to put a little lighter side on it, and believe me, child molestation, allegations proven or not, is not funny. But I try to be very mindful of that.
While you're on there for a comedy network, you don't think it's funny what's happening to Michael Jackson. You think he's been set up. You think this is a show trial. So I would guess that you think he's going to walk.
Oh, I'm unless, like you just said to Miss London, if something absolutely bizarre, unknown, and devastatingly 180 degrees different happens, he's definitely going to walk.
All of these networks seem to focus in on child stars and take special joy at counting every little mistake that they've made, every sin of omission or commission that they've made. Do you think that may be a part of it with Michael Jackson? Do you think there's a target on Michael Jackson's back, and a lot of people like to see this guy get knocked around?
Well, that's just psychology. There are many, 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 many people who are jealous and envious. Of people who have star power or money or fame, and they will look for and try to find any way possible to hurt those people. That's why I am very chagrined that Michael is so reckless with his choices of associations and friendships with children and adults, because you have to always be mindful to shun the appearance of evil, because if you don't, people are going to use your weakness against you and go after you.
Tom, first of all, the video is courtesy of LunaJoke67. Your thoughts on the late Gary Coleman?
Well, he said a lot of things that I agree with. You know, I had heard he'd made a few mocking remarks about Michael, particularly with race, which I didn't like. But in this particular interview, what he said made a lot of sense. And yes, you know, quite honestly, Michael was a little, you know, reckless is not the only word. Michael was defiant of people like Tom
right.
Snedden. Michael's attitude was, I know I'm not doing anything wrong, and I'm a person with a unique ability to change the world in positive ways, to focus the world's attention on our children and their need for love and attention and caring. And I'm not going to be scared by these people who are trying to make me into something I'm not. I'm going to do what I can to make the world a better place, to spread kindness and generosity and love and caring, you know, to everyone I can. And if they want to, you know, try and falsely accuse me of something I haven't done, it's just not going to stop me. I guess, you know, you could describe that as reckless. But Michael wanted to make a difference, and he knew that he was in a real situation where he could make a difference. And I think he changed the world in so many positive ways. But, you know, back to Gary Coleman, he made a lot of remarks there that are quite, you know, quite perceptive, I think. You know, child stars,
yeah, absolutely.
Stars of any age, you know, generate jealousy, and they have a desire, particularly in America, to take them down, to expose them in nasty ways, to you know, take their success and their advantages in life and turn them against them. People can be very mean-spirited. And I know in the United States, you know, the media likes to see someone go sky high and then, you know, fall on their face. It makes for a good drama. And
it makes
Michael
for a
Jackson,
good rag story.
Sure.
Yeah.
In the Michael Jackson trial, you had the biggest celebrity in the world, and the media was just eager to see him fall and be destroyed. I mean, they were when, you know, when those acquittals came down, I remember after I hugged Michael and hugged the members of our team, I looked back in the courtroom and I could see all these media people were just, you know, upset because the big story was over. They wanted to see Michael, you know, convicted. They wanted to see him shaking and trembling. They wanted to see the sheriff put handcuffs on his wrist and march him into jail. And then they
you could have had sentencing day if from their standpoint. There would be a sentencing day, right?
There would be a sentencing date set in the future. There would be all sorts of stories coming from the jail as to what he was eating and what he was wearing and what he was reading and would he kill himself and who was being allowed in to visit with him. And they were looking forward to seeing him in a jailhouse outfit with chains, looking, you know, horrible. This was going to make for a great story for them. And they feel that the acquittals cost them a lot of money. It's a sad commentary on the world we live in, but because he went so high, so many powerful people wanted to see him sink so low. And thank God we avoided that. We stopped it.
Yeah, no question, in 2005. Now, if you would have got a couple of counts, like the last Charlie, what's the minimum that he could have went to jail for? Like, you know, there were four misdemeanors, right? They would help.
He was indicted on 10 felony counts. And
right.
The prosecutors would have been very happy just to convict him on one. They would
really?
Have liked more. But if they had convicted him on just one felony, he would have spent many years in prison. Many years. He could have spent,
talking about the lesser included, one.
The lesser, if he were convicted of one of the lesser included offenses, he probably would not have spent any time in jail, but he would have been on probation, and he would have had to take courses and things of that sort.
And he couldn't go to Bahrain or anything
a lot of commentators at the time were saying if he's convicted of a misdemeanor of giving alcohol to children who are underage, that he'll do some jail time. But he likely would not have if that were the only conviction. And I don't know if you remember this, but the grand jury indicted Michael Jackson on 10 felony counts. Conspiracy, child molestation, attempted child molestation, and giving alcohol to a minor for purposes of child molestation. They were very serious felons.
Right.
It was the judge who wanted to give the jury the option to convict on misdemeanors if they acquitted him on the last four felony counts. The last four felony counts were giving alcohol to a minor for purposes of child molestation. And what the judge instructed the jury was that if you don't find him guilty of those felony counts, you then are to consider whether to convict him of a misdemeanor count of giving alcohol to a person who's underage. And I think the judge did that because he realized that the prosecutors could lose, and he wanted to give them an opportunity to see him convicted of something. That was how I read it. Because neither the prosecutors...
Oh, really?
The prosecutors did not ask the judge for those lesser-included offense instructions, and we didn't ask the judge for those lesser-included offense instructions. He just said he was going to do it.
Prosecution-oriented, Judge Rodney Melville.
He definitely was pro-prosecution. He gave us some fair rulings as well, but he was generally pro-prosecution, yes. And I think he wanted to give them a chance to come out with a conviction on something. That's how I read it.
Unbelievable. Okay, I have a list of names here. I'm going to read them one by one, and I want you to give me what comes to your mind. Okay, let's start with Dr. Conrad Murray.
I don't want to express on radio the words I'd like to express.
Let's
just say he's in the right place.
Well, unfortunately, I hear he'll be getting out in a couple months. Because he'll be done with two of the 4 years.
Well, that's
if
what
that's
I hear
accurate.
People, but But I have utter contempt for this person. I think he sold out his patient. He violated every ethical rule, you know, I've ever heard that applied to physicians. And I think he was selfish, was narcissistic. He's still trying to blame Michael Jackson for what happened. And I have utter contempt for him.
Martin Bashir.
Despicable. That's the word that comes to mind. I don't know if you know this, but the day Michael died, I was in trial with Susan Yu. We were defending the largest real estate. At one point, he was the highest grossing real estate agent in the country. He was in a federal criminal case in Los Angeles. Came out of the courthouse, was told that Michael had died, called my office, and my message machine was filled to capacity, but I was getting calls from all over the world from media. And one of the early calls was from Martin Bashir, who I had never spoken to since I cross-examined him. He was the prosecution's first witness in their case against Michael. And he basically tried to say that he admired me and never meant any harm, and left his phone number for me to call. And, of course, I never called him. I find him despicable. I think what he did to Michael was just unspeakable, the way he manipulated him and set him up to create this scandalous documentary that I think he thought would promote himself, and it certainly did. And I have contempt for him, too.
Katherine Jackson.
Wonderful, wonderful lady. Kind, gentle, caring, giving, spiritual. Michael called her a saint. You know, she hasn't always had an easy time in life. She's had to deal with a lot of pressures and tragedies and problems have made things very difficult at times. But I think she's a human being who's done her best and a very, very nice lady.
Joe Jackson.
You know, he's taken a lot of criticism through the years. But he never was bad to me. Michael, you know, despite what issues he had with him, consistently said that Joe had forced him to develop his talent in a way that probably no one else could have. I think he was an old school parent. He believed in discipline. But I will tell you one funny story. After the last not guilty verdict came down, I hugged Michael. I hugged our teammates. We were so happy. And I turned around, and Joe Jackson walked up to me in the courtroom. He put his hand out to shake my hand, and he said, "You're almost as good as me."
he's still smooth. At the age he is, he's a smooth criminal. Okay, as we go along here, Howard Weitzman.
Well, he's the attorney for the Jackson estate, a very competent lawyer. You know, I've had some interaction with him, and he's been pretty decent and fair with me, the estate. We had a bill that had not been paid for work we did long after the verdict, and it was Susan who did most of it. And he called me up, said the estate wanted to pay the bill, but we deserved to have it paid, and so he was very decent to us. And from what I can see, he's doing an excellent job for the estate.
Yeah, no question. Wade Robson.
I am very disappointed in what Wade did recently, because he was my first witness in the trial. He was adamant that Michael had never inappropriately touched him at any time. He is a very intelligent young man, very talented. And in that trial, you know, when he was being vigorously attacked by Ron Zonin, the prosecutor, he said it's ridiculous for anyone to assume that he had ever, you know, been inappropriately touched by Michael. And I'm very, very disappointed at his change in position. I don't believe it's true. And I'm very disappointed in what he is, you know, trying to say and do at the moment. But I have to say that in that trial, he and his mother and his sister all testified. They stood strong for Michael Jackson, and they had a lot to do with the acquittal. And I don't believe he's ever suffered from repressed memory, and I don't believe that he's only coming to grips now with some alleged molestation. I don't believe it's true at all.
It's weird because he's in a chat. We found some of the Michael Jackson fan clubs found, and back in 2004, he writes, he writes basically, "I'm so upset about this. I want to set the record straight." You know what I'm saying? Just off the top of my head from what I remember. But he was even more adamant in this little chat where he was discussing that he's, so getting ready to, testify and just like, what an ugly thing to do. I mean, he couldn't go out of his way anymore. I'd never seen a 180 like this ever.
It's just, totally unfortunate. Michael's life was plagued by this kind of behavior. That's one of the reasons
yes.
Michael had such trouble. He had such trouble trusting people. Because, how many times did he think someone was his friend? He would go out of his way to assist them in some meaningful way. And the next thing he knew, they'd be turning on him with a lawsuit or with an accusation that was false. I mean, poor Michael was plagued with this kind of reality. Made him very distrusting, made him feel very lonely. And I'm just appalled at what Wade has done. I really am.
Yeah, just terrible. All right, let's go out to Texas, 806. You're on the line with Tom Mesereau, 806. Please state your name.
Hello, my name is Christy Miller, and I've been a Michael Jackson fan for years. And I also have a lot of respect and admiration for Mr. Mesereau for standing by Michael in his darkest hour.
Well, thank you.
Also, I know Michael has showed you his vitiligo before during the trial, but have you learned from any sources that he also suffered from lupus?
Yes, I've heard that from a number of people. I don't know the details. It was never discussed with me while I was representing him. He talked to me about vitiligo, but he never talked to me about lupus. And, I know he suffered from vitiligo because he showed me his back one day. He lifted his shirt up and said, "Tom, look." And he had white patches and brown patches in his skin, and he was very sensitive and very self-conscious about it. And he was very upset with a lot of the jokes being told about him, and he was just trying to deal with a disease. But lupus was not ever discussed with me at any time. He didn't, and no one else did. But in recent times, I've certainly read and been told that he did suffer from lupus. I don't know exactly what the truth is. There's so many stories circulate about, Michael, but I have heard that, yes.
All right, thank you. I love you very much.
Well, thank you so much. Good luck.
Yeah, a lot of people question lupus and vitiligo, and you can basically confirm the vitiligo, right?
Yes, I definitely can confirm that. There's no question he had vitiligo. He showed it to me. He discussed it with me. He was very sensitive about it. And he was actually very hurt by some of these jokes that he was trying to be white.
That was terrible.
That he was abandoning the black community, which wasn't true. And he was very self-conscious about it. But he tried to deal with it as best he could. Whether he used creams or whether he used medication, he had his bodyguard with an umbrella coming in and out of the courtroom because he couldn't be in the sunlight. But he definitely suffered from vitiligo, for sure. That I do know.
Okay, I got some questions that were left to me here from Facebook, Laura. If Michael Jackson was on meds, why didn't Debbie Rowe step in and help him, in your opinion?
Well, I didn't know Michael or Debbie when they were married. Right. You know, I knew Randy Jackson for a number of years, but I didn't know Michael. I met Michael when they wanted me to step in and take over his criminal defense. So that's the kind of thing you'd have to ask Debbie about. I mean, you know, she testified the other day that he was going to various doctors and that the doctors were competing with each other about who was going to give him the best medication, and she sounded, from what I read, pretty disgusted by that whole thing. Maybe she did her best to try and help him with these physicians. I don't know. And again, unless you ask each physician why they did what they did, unless you look at their records, and, you know, I think they have a right to give you their view of things, but Debbie's perception obviously was not very good about some of these physicians. But my feeling is you've got to ask them what their position was. But, you know, haven't we seen in cases of celebrities, you know, Marilyn Monroe and Elvis Presley and poor Michael Jackson, that, you know, doctors, they seem to find doctors who will give them lots of medications that I don't think are very productive and very healthy. But nevertheless, I don't know what Debbie did or didn't do. She may have tried to help him with this problem. I just don't know. All I can tell you
is you weren't in the circle at that particular, you weren't in his inner circle at that particular time. Right?
Yeah, no, I wasn't. Hang on for just 1 second.
Sure.
Okay, pardon me. No, I just didn't, you know, I'm not a witness to any of that stuff. But I will never forget her testimony in the trial when she, you know, all the media said she was going to come in there and help the prosecution. And she came, got up there, and she was one of our best witnesses. She really looked at Michael, and she really was there to protect him, to defend him. She said he was a wonderful person, a wonderful father. He was being taken advantage of, people around him, and she clobbered the prosecution in that case. Really,
yeah, and you know, Tom, I remember it like it was yesterday. Diane Diamond was out there, and she goes, "Oh my, this is Debbie testifying in 05. Oh my, this is not what the prosecution wanted." I remember those words because me and my friends always laugh.
she just, you know, she went sideways on them, and they were just humiliated by this. They wined and dined her the night before her testimony at one of the finest restaurants, and they thought they really had her under their control. And she really, she's a person who speaks her own mind, I'll say that. But, you know, in that trial and in this current civil trial, I think she's really stood up for the Jacksons. That's been my impression.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Luna Joe out of the Netherlands. When Murray was convicted, they used the word alleged victim and alleged person, Dr. Murray, when the verdicts were read. I don't know if you heard that.
I'm not sure exactly what they're referring to, but clearly Michael was the victim.
When a verdict is reached, it's no more alleged, right?
Well, that's true. I mean, he was convicted of involuntary manslaughter. He was convicted of causing the death of Michael Jackson.
Right. So. And the lady who said, we the jury find Dr. Conrad, alleged victim, Michael Joe Jackson, an alleged person, Dr. Conrad Murray. She used the word alleged twice, I believe, once definitely. Twice, I'm pretty sure, in that case, it's out there, it's on video.
I would have to look at the words, but clearly, you know, he was convicted of a serious felony, and the felony was involuntary manslaughter, and the jury found that he was criminally negligent in causing the death of Michael Jackson. You can't be convicted of manslaughter unless someone dies. Can't be convicted of murder unless someone dies. You can be convicted of attempted murder or attempted manslaughter if you try to murder or you try to cause the death in some way and the person doesn't die. But nevertheless, you know, there was a
Jack.
Yeah, and but basically they just wanted to, maybe if you heard the tone of how she said it, because when they read off the verdict, you're not supposed to say alleged anymore. Is that accurate?
I'd have to look and see what they said. I really don't know what they said.
Okay.
I just have to look at it more carefully.
Well, in a couple days, it's going to be Michael. He'd be 54 years old. Could you believe it?
No. It's just so sad. It seems like I was with him yesterday, you know, and it's just, it's very, very sad.
Totally. I dug up something very good. This also courtesy of Luna Joe, back from 1993. Listen to this. I think you get a big kick out of it.
Ranch, I met a young girl who really swept me off my feet. When we come back, we'll meet the 7-year-old whose best friend just happens to be Michael Jackson. Back in a moment. Jackson, as we've often heard, is surrounded by children, and through the years he's befriended young actors like Emmanuel Lewis and Macaulay Culkin. But you don't have to be a child star to get Michael's attention. I first met my next guest when I was visiting Michael's ranch a few weeks ago to shoot the promos. Her best friend just happens to be the biggest superstar in the world, and the whole universe saw her by Michael's side during his Super Bowl performance. Please meet Amy. Amy, we're glad to have you here. And the day we were there shooting our promo, Amy wanted us to finish so she could go out and play with Michael. Is that right? What's he really like, Amy?
He's just like a kid. He wants to stay a kid, but he grew up.
Do you spend a lot of time with him?
When I go up there, I spend almost most of my time with him doing it.
Yeah, playing.
Mm-hmm.
Playing. What do y'all play? What do y'all play?
I play all the time.
She's a child, would y'all please? Amy, what do y'all play? What do you play?
What are you playing?
I play on his rides, and we play hide and go seek.
And how did you meet him? We want to know that, so we can do the same thing.
Well, I was doing a commercial with him,
And
I was 4, and I didn't know anything about him. And I went into his trailer, and I sat right up on his lap, and he said to himself that he was going to be friends for life.
The two of you. Now, these are Amy's parents here, and I was saying when I was there that day, and I saw you all, the whole family was there, the whole stand-up guys. They were all on the rides in the amusement park after the shoot.
And you.
I was there, too, yes.
You were leading my
and cat. Wait a minute, and what did Amy say to me? Amy says, you're not going to go on that grandma ride, are you? Which was the Ferris wheel, which is about my speed.
Yes.
So, and I said to you, do your kids know how lucky they are to be able to come up to Michael Jackson's house, like, and just kind of hang out and have root beer floats?
Anytime they want. You know, in the beginning, like Amy said, she had no idea who Michael was when she was 4 years old. He was just a nice guy that she met and a friend. Our boys kind of knew who he was and knew he was a real famous singer, but he was just a friend. He made you feel so at ease, and he was so fun to be with. And that's just how we are. We're just friends with him.
Now, I heard this the night I left, that you all were going to Toys R Us and they were closing the store and you were going to shop a lot. Is that true?
Very.
Well, one of the things I intend to talk to Michael about tonight is that one of the things that impressed me the most is when I went to the ranch where we're shooting the commercial inside the theater there. There is, inside the wall at Michael's house, there are beds for sick children.
I was so moved by that, because in order to build walls into the room with beds in them for children means you genuinely have to care about them. My next guest is a mother of a young boy whose life and death struggle touched Michael Jackson's heart. Young Ryan White was diagnosed with AIDS in 1984, and his hometown of Kokomo, Indiana, flew into an outrage. Ryan was blocked from going to school, his family forced to leave town.
I don't think he should be here. If people with chickenpox and measles can't come, why should he?
When Ryan died in 1990, many celebrities turned out to pay homage to this unlikely hero in the battle against AIDS. Michael Jackson dedicated this song to his valiant young friend.
Like a comet blazing across the evening sky, gone too soon. Like a rainbow fading in the twinkling of an eye, gone too soon.
Welcome Ryan's mother, Jenny White. You know, oftentimes celebrities can attach themselves to a cause or be interested for the moment, but you know that Michael's feelings were quite different.
I saw a very sincere Michael, and somebody that, it's strange, after Ryan died, I asked Michael, I said, well, what is it that connected you and Ryan? And he said, you know, most people can't get over the awe of who I am, so nobody can ever act normal around me. He said, Ryan knew how I wanted to be treated because that's how he wanted to be treated. Ryan spent 5 days with Michael in 1990, right before his death. And Ryan was so worried about being a burden to Michael because he couldn't hardly walk. He was very ill.
What, Ryan went up to the ranch?
Yes, Ryan went to, mm-hmm. to the ranch and spent 5 days with him. And they did fun things. And the first night I said, well, what did you do? And he said, well, we spent 3 hours watching Three Stooges movies. I mean, this was something that Ryan loved comedy, so does Michael. They went shopping, and I said, you know, who drove? And he said, well, Michael drove the Bentley. And I said, Michael drove himself? And, yeah, me and Michael went shopping.
How are you handling it now? How are you? Are you okay? You're doing...
With Ryan's death, mm-hmm. It's very, very hard. I have formed a Ryan White Foundation dealing with adolescents, dealing with all kinds of adolescents, whether you have AIDS, whether you don't have AIDS, whether your parents have AIDS, whether your siblings have AIDS. So I'm keep active in doing the things that Ryan was doing and educating our young people about AIDS.
That is good. Thanks, Gene. Grown women admit when they reveal their fantasies about the man who thrills them, Michael Jackson. Coming back. His fans agree that Michael Jackson isn't only bad, but wait until you hear what else they think.
Oh, he's lovely.
He's just like this with the Beatles.
We can play in it till we see him.
I love you, Michael.
23 years Michael Jackson has been in our life. Okay.
Very big deal.
Yeah.
This 23 years.
This is him. This is the guy we fell in love with, right?
I fell in love. I was planning my wedding at 9. Truly planning my wedding. I was convinced that I would marry this man, and I am still waiting.
You know, when I was 5 and 6, my girlfriend and I were Michael and Marlon's wives.
Would I marry him today? Absolutely. I still think I'm going to marry him.
I was so in love with Michael that the majority of my boyfriend's name was Michael.
I wanted to be black. Literally wanted to be black because I thought then I could marry Michael Jackson. I wanted to be black. Literally wanted to be black because I thought then I could marry Michael Jackson. I know that sounds awful. I'm not trying to be prejudiced.
Say you wanna be by his side, you got to be. Say you wanna be by his side, you got to be.
It started out very small. Started out with me lying and saying that I had met him after the concert. My friend Lisa and I had met him after the concert. And the girl was so gullible, she believed it, and I just went with it. And for months, I had her thinking that I was dating Michael Jackson. Months, and she would call, and I would go, oh, he's so sweet. He just, Michael just, I just got off the phone with Michael from California.
He said he's not coming back because he's still with me.
I thought we would have lovely children together, too. I thought we'd make a nice coupling. I really was convinced.
Well, I'll tell you, Tom, back then, 93, your thoughts on that cut from Oprah Winfrey.
Well, you know, I was upset with Oprah Winfrey, the way she, you know, treated Michael during the trial. I wasn't watching her show, but my understanding is she was having shows about pedophilia and things of that sort. And I didn't like that. But I must say the segments that you played, you know, have reminded me of just what an unbelievable person he was with Ryan White, with others. Incredibly kind. I mean, you know, there was a young man in Orange County, California, whose father doused him with gasoline and burned a large portion of his body. And Michael took him under his was paying for his surgeries and paying for him to get therapy. And he did the same thing with Ryan White. He tried his best to help Ryan White. I know for a fact that there are many, many disabled children that, you know, it's never been publicized, that he used to pay their medical bills. I remember Grace's nanny told me how many children there were everywhere who couldn't pay medical bills for their disabilities, and they were leading tragic lives, and Michael stepped in and was paying their bills secretly. He was doing it for publicity. And he did so much to just help children, to help the planet, to spread kindness and love and generosity and caring. In fact, the Arvizos, you know, why did he get involved with them? He was trying to help this kid who was recovering from cancer.
That's right.
Unfortunately, we live in a very cruel, you know, world filled with greed and filled with just jealousy, and not everyone is a decent person out there, but Michael tried to see the best in people, tried to bring out the best, and he wanted to spread kindness everywhere he could. The generosity he extended in his lifetime, not just financially was amazing, but what he did just with his music, with his message, with his presence. You know, we all know that he had a rule that when he went around the world doing concerts, he would always visit a children's hospital. And he did so much good. But we live in a cruel planet. People try to tear him down. And I think it was Deepak Chopra who said he was a gentle soul in a cruel world. And I love that statement. I think it's a very accurate one.
And very fitting. Indeed.
We lost a very special person, unfortunately.
Yeah. The day we lost it, the director who... John Landis, who helped him direct Thriller, he was actually in the video and the making, the main part of that Thriller video. I found some commentary, so I saved it here for the special as we get closer to his birthday. Let's take a listen to John Landis as he gets emotional with talking about... the king of pop, Michael Jackson. Let's take a listen.
Michael, you know, it was, he had all kinds of issues, and, you know, there was a lot of strangeness. And the bottom line, though, he was a very sweet guy. He was a lovely guy who had just unbelievable. You know, death by celebrity, I think, is a saying. But to have that kind of talent, the guy was incredible, you know. I mean, it's so silly I'm getting upset, but he was an extraordinary, forgive me. I apologize. It's not like me. He was very, very, clearly something about Michael touched people. And regardless of all the jokes and all the eccentricities and odd behaviors and wackiness, you know, the truth is, it's amazing. You know, I'm very privileged. I'm very lucky to have collaborated with an artist like that, someone so amazing. And it's not fair, you know. He's only 50. It's not fair. I'm very upset. I feel stupid. I'm sorry. Mike was nuts, but he was terribly sweet. I mean, he was a genuinely caring person. And he, you know, he's someone who was denied a childhood, who tried to, you know, you've heard all the Peter Pan analogies, and he grew up like that in front of the camera. It's weird. People ask me, you know, what's it like working with Michael Jackson? When we made Thriller, Michael was 20, and it was like working with an incredibly gifted 10-year-old. And in no way do I mean that as a criticism. It was, he had real, he was emotionally stunted. I don't know. He's certainly someone who wore his heart on his sleeve, let's put it that way. And he always made me laugh. I always made him laugh. And I was always able to say, Mike, what the hell are you doing? That's too weird for me, you know. And he would laugh. He'd dismiss it. Oh, John, he'd say. After Thriller, we went to Disney World. And I have this photograph in my library I really treasure, which is a really silly photo of Michael. Well, it's Michael Jackson, Mickey Mouse, and me. A guy took, like, two pictures when I heard this deafening noise. And I looked and I saw the security guy, this big guy, freaking out, you know, talking into his microphone. And I thought, what is it? And I turned around. And I don't know how to explain it. It's the only time in my lifetime I was truly terrified. I thought, we're dead. And it was a sea of people. So, I mean, they completely surrounded this island of grass. They were held back by this little chain. And when I say a sea of people, people as far as you could see in every direction, thousands of people. I don't know how many people, but thousands of people, all of whom were hysterical. The kind of hysterical like Beatle, Elvis, Sinatra hysterical. I mean, they were Michael Jackson hysterical. And I looked and I thought, oh, my God. And it got louder, and the screaming. I mean, you had to shout to hear the person next to you because of the screaming. And they were, you know, like there, there, there. And, you know, at Disney World and Disneyland, the characters in those costumes are never allowed to speak. And, you know, Mickey looks at me and goes, holy f***ing, I have to hear that, man. You know, and I realized, oh, if Mickey's scared. And I don't know how long it was, but from nowhere, this Cadillac limousine, I'll never forget it. I don't know where it came from, just Disney magic, this Cadillac limousine, and the security people grabbed Mickey, Michael, and me, all three of us, threw us into this car with Mickey's giant head, you know, we're like, so there's Mickey, Michael, and me thrown into this car, and they slammed the doors, and the chains broke, and it was like the ocean, it was like surf, this wall of people came, like, you know, the Sorcerer's Apprentice, like, around the car. And Mickey and I are just plotzing. The driver was going, I don't know what to do. I don't know what to do. I said, don't drive. You'll kill somebody. And Michael was like, hi. Hello. I'm totally not fazed. I think Michael would have loved what people said. I mean, people spoke very eloquently, sometimes over the top, but you know, Michael was over the top, so it was very moving. It was great. I'm very impressed with the whole thing. I'm glad I went.
Okay, Tom, your thoughts on his former director of Thriller, John Landis?
Well, he said a lot of things that I found quite curious. You know, Michael was a genius, and geniuses dance to their own drummer. You know, there's a reason why geniuses see things that we don't see. They hear things that we don't hear. They understand things that we don't understand. And he sort of was suggesting a lot of that, that this was a very sweet, kind person with unbelievable talent who saw the world, you know, in his way and acted the way he was, nothing phony about him, very eccentric, different from others because of his enormous talent and his ability to see and hear and do things that we can't see, hear, and do. You know, it was interesting to get John Landis's perception because he worked with him very closely on some very important projects. I've never heard it before, but when I knew Michael, John Landis wasn't one of his close friends at that point. But
there was some lawsuits going on.
It was very interesting to get his perspective on Michael. But one of the world's greatest geniuses. I mean, you know, there'll probably never be anyone quite like him. But I've always said that when you look at the fame he had and you look at the money he had and you realize that he could have just lived a very selfish life, partying and thinking about himself, but that's not what he wanted. He wanted to change the world in a way that he thought he was uniquely capable of doing. And that was to spread kindness and love and decency everywhere he could. But unfortunately, we live in a cruel world, and the forces of evil try to surround him and destroy him. And
I was debating with somebody, and they said for sure that Elvis would be before Michael. And I don't think it's even close. Michael was national, wild, you know, the whole different circumstances. Elvis is before my time, so I don't know, maybe you could speak to a little bit of Elvis and the comparison?
I think Elvis is great. I love his music and his dancing. And again, I think he's someone who was fundamentally a very nice, kind person. But I think fame and what it surrounds you with got to him, you know, in many destructive ways. But, you know, I'm biased because I knew Michael and think so highly of Michael. But I think if you go to different continents around the world, I'm not sure how well known Elvis is, but everyone knows Michael Jackson.
Right. The Jacksons and, you know, the Beatles, I guess. A certain group there, I would say, you could put with Michael. Would you put Muhammad Ali in that special group?
Well, of course. Muhammad Ali, at one point, was the best-known person in the world in his day. Muhammad Ali was
prime.
A great person. Absolutely, a great man in so many different ways. Not just as an athlete, but as a warrior for civil rights, a man of tremendous courage, willing to end his career for the sake of civil rights, willing to be jailed, someone who just was not content to simply make money and be famous. He wanted to make a difference as well, and he did. Muhammad Ali is one of my heroes as well. So, fame brings people to great heights, and success brings people to enormous mountaintops. But it also, unfortunately, attracts negativity, and, you know, some people can't handle it too well, but as I've said many, many times, Michael was a man who wanted to change the world and make it a kinder and nicer place, and he succeeded. He did it. His influence on the world will always be an enormous one, as far as I'm concerned.
No question. Have you got a chance to follow Justin Bieber? Or at least he's been in a lot of trouble, you know, smoking pot, getting caught. Doing all kinds of crazy stuff. MJ would never have done that in his younger days. Do you know anything about Bieber? And do you see why he's doing this?
No, I only know what I see on TV or what I see in the newspapers, so I don't know any more than you do. I've never met him, but I hope he's not going to be destroyed by becoming too successful and too famous at too early an age. I certainly hope not. You know, it's very tough to be very young and spirited and famous and successful at the same time. Suddenly everybody wants to be your friend. Everybody's got their hand out for something.
Right.
It can be very difficult. And it made Michael a very lonely person. He didn't know who he could trust. People just kept turning on him. Even during the trial, as you know, there were many celebrities that Michael thought would stand up for him, and they didn't. They wanted nothing to do with that trial. But the real exceptions were Chris Tucker and Macaulay Culkin. I'll never forget what stand-up guys they were, what dear friends they were. And nobody was going to tell them, stay away from that trial in Santa Maria. Their attitude to me, and I met them separately, that was, whenever he needs us, we're there. We don't care what anybody thinks. We don't care what anybody wants. And they're just wonderful, wonderful guys. You only really know who your friends are when you're in trouble. That's when you truly find out. And Michael
and
really
you know out. What? Hits the ground. When blank hits the ground and your friends are there, I always say, that's who you know, who your friends are. When you're going through your worst, you know, and your friends are there, or, you know, not there or there, that's who you could really, you know, sum up. So.
Well, Jordan, I've got to be in court tomorrow, so I'm going to have to.
Yes.
I'm going to take off.
As we get
this. Thank you so much for the honor and privilege of being on your show again. And you're a true friend of Michael Jackson and a true, you're making major contributions to reminding people just what an extraordinary and wonderful person he was. And I do commend you for that.
Yes, and if you can, a little birthday shout out to Michael. Because it's coming up in a few days.
I'm very honored and grateful that I knew him. I'm tremendously honored that I was able to take him out of a very difficult situation, the most difficult situation in his life. He was a man of love, kindness, and spirituality, and decency. A man who took art and music and dance and choreography to unheard of levels and tried to use his talents in a way that would just help people and heal the world. And it was a real honor to know him. I'm sad that he's gone. He went way too soon. He had so much more to offer the planet, but I feel so blessed that I knew him in the way that I did, and I will always be a fan.
Absolutely. And one last thing, the AEG trial should, be coming to an end in another, 6 weeks or so, you say?
That's what they say. It's been a long, drawn-out affair. AEG is fighting, tooth and nail. They don't seem to think they have any responsibility for Michael's death. Based on the evidence I've seen, I think they do. And I'm pulling for Catherine and the kids. I hope they win real big.
And your thoughts on Brian Pandish? Is he doing a good job?
He's a fabulous lawyer. He's, Randy called me at one point when they were trying to figure out who to hire and asked me what I thought of Brian Pandish. And I told him that I thought Brian Pandish was the number one plaintiff civil trial lawyer in America. And
really?
I thought no one else in Los Angeles even came close to him. And Randy then asked me, would I meet with he and Brian, and I at Brian's office, which I did. And after the meeting, Randy again wanted to know my thoughts, and I told him that I think he's the best, but nobody even comes close. He's the one Catherine and Michael's children are going to want. Then Randy asked me, would I talk to Catherine about Brian Pandish, and I said I would, and I met Catherine at Janet's apartment. Jermaine and Randy were there. And I told Catherine, I said, he is number one in America. He's the best. And you should hire him, and he should be your civil plaintiff's lawyer. This is a specialty, and he's the best. Don't talk to anyone else in Los Angeles. Brian Pandish is number one. And she listened to me, and I hope they win because I think they're in the right.
Do you think you'll get called?
I don't know.
At this point, I'm
still on the witness list. I don't know if I'm going to get called or not. But I have to be available in case Brian Tanish wants to call me. At this point, if he calls me, it would be in the plaintiff's rebuttal case. You know, the Kaplan and the kids, through their lawyers, put on their case. Now the defense is putting on their case. And
they get a rebuttal?
Brian, yeah, they would get an opportunity to rebut the defense case, and it's possible they'll call me at that one.
Oh, okay. So I would say 6-7 weeks minimum, right?
I think so.
Okay, so maybe we'll speak to you then, Tom. Thank you so much. The fans across Michael Jackson Nation appreciate it. Tom, I can't say enough words. Thank you of coming on the radio hotline tonight. I can't express. It's just the gratitude is just so much. Words can't express it.
Thank you
so much.
My best to all the fans, and keep the faith. You know, Michael was a special person. He'll always be in our lives in one form or another. And keep the faith and spread the word. He was just the greatest as far as I'm concerned.
Happy birthday, Michael Jackson. And thank you, Tom Mesereau. We will speak to you soon. Thank you, Tom.
Thank you so much. Bye.
Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, Tom Mesereau joined us. Thank you, Tom. Okay, it looks like Monday, of course, we will be back at 7 p.m. Also working with Stacey Honowitz. We might get her soon. Also, I'm going to have somebody here that will teach people how to stop smoking. So that will be coming up. Also, Jose Baez to be coming up soon. Also, keep up with me on Twitter at Mr. King Jordan. Follow me right there. Also, facebook.com/KingJordanRadio. I hope you guys enjoyed the interview. Please leave your comments below. He's really cool, Tom Mesereau. I'm so happy that he got to hear Luna Joe 67's great videos. And she has great series, Luna Joe. What Did Happen to Michael Jackson? You want to follow it. I watch it at least 3-4 times. But there's over 40 videos. No, there's maybe 80 videos. 85 videos of Michael Jackson. So you definitely want to listen to that. Thanks, everybody. This is King Jordan. And I'm signing off, and we'll speak to you next time.